So, after just now you learn about the parameter that you use to describe and explore your data set, okay? And then you learn about the distribution, frequency distribution, the probability distribution, and learn about the parameter that you use to describe the distribution. And now we're going to discuss in more detail about the distribution. So first is the normal distribution. Okay. Then after that, after you understand the concept of the normal distribution, then you have to know the concept about the standard normal curve. This is very, very important, standard normal curve. Okay. You have to make sure you understand this one. Okay. So after this, maybe not after this lecture, but after you have done your assignment, and hopefully you can, you'll be able to explain normal distribution, what is normal distribution, explain the standard normal curve. So these are the two different things. Eh? It's related, but somehow it's different. And then calculate the proportion of a normal distribution. So these are the three things you have to know how to do. Okay, these are the basic, very, very basic. That's the reason why you learn this in your secondary school. Very basic. So the two things you want to learn, so normal distribution, so it's about the characteristic of the normal curve. You have to learn this. Okay. Then the standard normal curve. So it's a normal curve, but this curve is a standard one. That means that everyone uses it. Okay. And the normal curve that you have for is from your data set. Okay. Because your data set might be different from mine, so our normal curve might be different. But there's one curve, one normal curve that is same across the world. Okay, everyone uses it as a reference, which is the standard normal curve. And this is a curve that we use to calculate the proportion. Okay. So first one, normal distribution. So this is an empirical distribution, so it's based on your data. It's not a theoretical distribution, eh? It's exactly from your data. If you sample enough 1,000 data set or 10,000, 100,000 data set, if you plot your graph, you can get a very nice curve. And in the last lecture, you learned how to use mean and standard deviation to describe or characterize a population. So to describe a population means to describe the curve, correct? Okay. So this is the population. The population means doesn't mean the student, eh? So in this case it's the body height of the student. But the population mean is the body height of the students. Okay? If you measure the body weight, then you have another distribution curve. Okay? So now you have learned how to measure the mean standard deviation and you know about the distribution, then what is it for? Why you have to know this? The reason is that if you sample enough, most of the distribution will look similar to this. Okay. A distribution of the scale data is usually observed to a largely concentrate around the mean, the center. Okay, the center. Okay. Everything is concentrated here. You can see for the area under curve. And around the mean, and with progressively fewer observation towards the extreme of the range of values. See, it's getting less and less. Okay. You observe this even in your daily life without collecting data. Okay, it's seldom that you see very tall people and very short people. Okay, most of people is around this height. Okay. So the distribution pattern that we see is a normal curve, okay? The what you call the normal curve. So normal, normally in the normal environment condition, this is how the distribution should look like. It's a bell shape, and most score fall near the center and fewer at the extreme. So these are the characteristics. And usually it's symmetric. So if you take the median, okay, they mean the right hand, the right side of the curve, the distribution, and left side of the distribution is the same. Okay. And the skewness is zero. Mean, median, and mode are the same at the center, but the dispersion can change a bit. But not all bell-shaped curves are normal. Okay, so that's the reason why there's a mathematical definition of the theoretical normal curve. Okay, there's a mathematical formula describe the curve. Because this is a curve, right? Okay, this is a curve. So there's a mathematical definition. So that means there's a formula. So this is a formula. If you want to memorize it, you can choose to memorize it. It's not too difficult. So it seems it's quite a lot of the things here, but it's not many things. Okay, it's not many things. There are a few things you can recognize already. Okay. For example, the Y and S. Okay, so the Y is here, right? Okay, this is a Y and this is a S. Okay. So that means that if you put an S value, then you can get a Y value. Okay. So this definition of the curve. So S and Y is depend. Okay, it's depend. Okay, it's your input. Okay. Then after that you have a few constants, for example pi and exponential. Okay. These are the fixed value, right? Will not change, right? Okay. Then what is left? What else? This one and this one. Okay? Then what is left is just the parameters. Mean and standard deviation. Okay? So actually if you see it, the determinant for the shape of your normal curve is the mean and also standard deviation. That's all. Okay, so the variable is the SI is a variable value. Okay? And given a variable value, then you can calculate the relative probability. Okay, right, so far? So just imagine this scenario. So you can imagine that we use the example just now. So different location data. Okay, this is the distribution for all the body height for location A and C. Have the distribution curve, right? And each curve is defined by the same mathematical formula. Okay, the only difference is the mean and also the variance. Okay. So in this case, the mean is different, correct? In this case, the mean is the same, so the difference is the standard deviation, okay, or variance. This one? Okay. So this is just to. So just now we discussed this already, actually. But now I just want to put in the proper context, the mathematical definition. Okay. The reason is that we're going to use this formula later. Okay. So now you can see, actually, you can make some decision already. Okay. So for example, the red color is this location C, blue is location A. If I ask you to put a symbol here, larger, greater, equal, or smaller, you can, I'm pretty sure you can do it now. So for example, the mean of this one, blue color is larger than C. The green color is the same, okay? And the purple is the same. How about the standard deviation? Red and blue is the same. Green is larger than blue, and purple is larger than green, okay? So now you have some intuitive understanding, eh? About this parameter. It's not simply that you calculate, it's useless. It's very useful. Okay. Now, just imagine if I just show you this without showing the graph, okay, you can say something already, correct? By judging, by using this parameter, this four value, okay, without seeing all this graph. Okay. So we go talk more about the normal distribution. So the probability associated with the variable value under the probability distribution. So So the probability also associated with the range of the value represented by the area under the extreme value of the range. So for example, so just now it's a point estimate. So if I give you the S value, you can calculate the Y, right? But let's say now I want to ask what is the proportion or probability to have a student with the body height between 164 and 165. It's a range, it's an interval estimate. Okay. So you can calculate it easily, okay, by using this formula. Okay. So the idea is by using this formula to calculate the area. Once you have the area, then you get the probability. Okay, if you multiply the probability with the frequency, the n data, the size, then you can get the frequency. Okay, then how to calculate the area under curve by using this formula? So you can do this. You learned this before by using calculus. Something like this. Okay, it's the same formula that you put in, and then the first S value and the second input, right? Then you can calculate the area under curve, whatever curve. In this case, it's a normal curve. Okay, then you can calculate it. It's not too difficult, but it's very cumbersome. You can imagine that now if you have the data set, your data set, you can calculate this for your data set, correct? If you have another data set, you have to do the calculation again. Okay? So that's the reason why, to save all this calculative work, we use the standard normal curve as a shorthand.